Christmas is believing that when Jesus Christ was born, God came down from heaven on that first Christmas morn. Christmas is believing a gift to all mankind was wrapped and laid in a manger. You can have his gift of love this holy season. There's so much more to Christmas than just a feeling. In my heart I know that Christmas is believing that 2,000 years ago, the light that shined in the darkness and the world didn't know. Christmas is believing the Savior is Christ the Lord, and if we will believe Him, we will
Thank God for the Word of God. Thank God for Jesus Christ, who died, was buried, rose again. Thank God, the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses from all sin. Amen. Praise God. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. The holy men of God and women spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit of God. This is a God-breathed book. It's a precious word of God, a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction and righteousness, that the man, woman, boy, or girl may be completely furnished or perfect unto good works. We thank God for His Word. And we're in the book of Acts. You want to turn there to chapter 1. Starting a new series. It's a quite lengthy book. We've given you an outline of every chapter and some of the high points that's there. You have that you might take and use that as an outline as you study the book of Acts. So we find the book of Acts. Some of the people that we notice in the book of Acts, we know that the book of Acts was written by Dr. Luke. As he wrote the Gospel of Luke, we find that he also was led by the Spirit of God to write the book of Acts. And so we're so thankful for the men and women of God that's been called to share the Word of God. And as we go through the book of Acts, we find that it's a transitional book. We find the 39 books of the Bible, the Old Testament, was given by prophecy, prediction, types, and shadows, magnifying the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, who would come at God's appointed time, be born of a virgin, be born at the right time, the right place, and then raised up after he died and shed his blood, raised up the third day, defeating death, hell, and the demons of hell. We're so thankful for the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son. And so we want to look at Acts chapter 1, and we begin with verse 1. And what we'll do is read these. Let's see how many of the verses we have in Acts chapter 1. We have at least 26 verses. We're going to read each of them, and we know it's the seeing of God's word as you read it, and then as you hear it, those two different gates that are opened up into your soul and being. And the word of God affects every part of our being, and so it's so necessary that we look at it together. First of all, in Acts chapter 1, beginning with verse 1, the former treatise, that which was Luke's gospel, the former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day which he was taken up, after that through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. So we have the 39 books, and then we come on in the Bible that we have, the English Bible. Then we have the book of Acts. Well, then we have the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And they're good news that all these things were prophesied and predicted in the Old Testament are being fulfilled, already have been fulfilled. And then we come to the book of Acts, a transitional book, sort of dividing that period of time from the law and legal time until the age of grace, the church age in which we're living right now. And so the book of Acts was given. He says in verse 3, to whom also showed himself alive. See, he was alive after he was dead. He rose again after his passion, by many infallible proofs being seen of the 40 days and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Jesus, after he had risen, he met with his disciples 40 days, waiting for the day of Pentecost. We find those 40 days were very special. As he ministered to them from time to time, he would come and make himself known in those 40 days. And then we find in verse 4, and being assembled together with them, commanded them they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith, you've heard of me. That was a promise of the Holy Spirit of God. Now the Holy Spirit of God has always worked and always will work. And we find that he was very operative in the creation time when God created the angelic beings at that period of time. Then when he created man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostril breath of life, man became a living soul. God took Adam and took a rib and made Eve, and then we have the first man and woman. And we find that this precious word of God was given that you and I might know who we are in Christ. We're special people. The Bible says we're chosen out of spiritual darkness and brought into spiritual light. We're chosen out of darkness into God's marvelous light, the light of his word, the light of the Holy Spirit of God to lead us and guide us every day. And so he was beginning to teach his disciples. He was preparing them for a great work that was going to take place, as we find here in the book of Acts. We go into verse 5, and John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days since. Now the Holy Spirit of God would come upon the people of God in the Old Testament for power and strength. It would come upon them, and then he would go and leave them, but he would have. And then the Bible talks the Holy Spirit was upon them, and the Holy Spirit's going to be with you, and then he's going to be in you. So there's different functions of the Holy Spirit of God in the early church period of time. And this book of Acts was over 30-some years in the process of coming to pass, 30-some odd years in the making. So we come on to verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father has put in his own power, Go to verse 8 now, verse 8. This is a key passage. He says, but you shall receive power, he says to his disciples, those whom he has chosen. Now what I'd like to do, those 12 apostles that he was chosen, they're going to be mentioned in verse 13, at least 11 of them. But if you go with me, if you would go with me to the, hold your place in book of Acts, turn to Acts chapter 10. It names the apostles that were chosen by the Lord Jesus Christ to be his special apostles, those who were specially chosen. So in Matthew chapter 10, it names them. And it says in verse 1, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these. First there was Simon Peter and Andrew his brother, the son of Zebedee, and John his brother. Then there was Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas, Matthew, the publican, James, the son of Alphaeus, then Lebanus, or Thaddeus, then there was Simon the Canaanite, and then there was Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, or into any city of the Samaritans, enter not, but go ye to the lost sheep of the children of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely I give. Provide neither gold nor silver, nor brass, or in your purse, nor scrip for your journey, neither two coats, neither shoes, nor yet staves, for the workman is worthy of his meat. God was preparing them to do a great work. And the names were mentioned right there in Acts chapter 10. We go back to the book of Acts that we're studying. We come to another place, verse 9. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld him, he was taken up, a cloud received him out of their sight. So we find now the ascension. Christ came, he met with them 40 days, 40 nights. Infallible proofs were given that he had been raised from the dead. And then it says he finally ascended. Now verse 10 says, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, you men of Galilee, why stand you gazing, looking up into heaven? Why you just stand there gazing at heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you in heaven, shall come again in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Well, as he was ascending, he was seen in a visible form. And when he walked and talked among them in his resurrection body, they were able to handle him. They were able to touch him. They were able to feel him, put their hands in the nail prints of his hand. So they were able to converse with him, eat with him. And then we find that he was taken up. He ascended. And after he ascended, we find in verse 10 it says, and while they stood steadfastly toward heaven, he went up. Behold, two men stood by them. He shall come in like manner. When Jesus Christ comes again, now the first time he came, he was born of the Virgin. He came, robed himself in human form. That is, that he might be the sacrifice for the sins of all mankind. He had to have himself a human mortal body. And so God robed him in human form. We find after he had that special anointing of God, we find that he says, now, I want to know something. You're my special ambassadors. You're going to be my ambassador. You see, the child of God, we're his worshipers. We can now worship the Father. We go into the very presence of God, not like the Old Testament saints and the high priest. Jesus Christ, when he died, was buried, and rose again, the veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom. Now you and I can go into the very presence of God. What a privilege. What an honor to come to our Heavenly Father and converse with him one-on-one. We have that privilege and honor. And so we find that as we come here in verse 12, then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem about a Sabbath day's journey. Verse 13, and when they were come, they went up into the upper room where abode Peter James, John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, Simeon the Zealot, and Judas, the brother of James. Judas Iscariot, of course, had already been, he hung himself after he got 30 pieces of silver and bringing the enemy to Christ, they might take him into prison. And we find that he went out and hung himself. Now, after verse 14, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, with his brethren. Now, there had to be a choice. Someone had to take Judas Iscariot's place. And so he's called them to come together, and they began to look for another to take the place of Judas. So we find this in verse 15. In the days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of names together about 120. Men and brethren, the scripture must be fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus. Verse 17. He was numbered with us, had obtained part of this ministry. But finally he said, he had to do verse 18. Now the man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong burst asunder. In the midst the bowels gushed out. Verse 19. It was known unto all the dwellers in Jerusalem, insomuch as the field is called the proper tongue, Akalama, and say the field of blood. Now verse 20, for it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishop let none take. Verse 21, wherefore of these men which have covenanted with us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us. Verse 22, beginning from the baptism of John the Baptist, that the same day that he went up, taken up from us, must one be ordained to be a witness of his resurrection. So now they come together in verse 23, says this, and they appointed two, Joseph, called Barsabas, who was a surnamed Justus Matthias, and they prayed and said, thou Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whether of these two thou hast chosen. And he made, verse 25, then that he may take part in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. Verse 26, and they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. You and I have been numbered by the Spirit of God. We look around today and we find that some of our loved ones and some of those who have been coming to our church are no longer with us. God has taken them home to be with him at his appointed time. And yet you and I are left here to be worshipers of God. We should worship him in spirit and in truth. We have the Spirit of God living within us now. And our bodies are his temples. And God wants our temples to be holy unto the Lord. And so God wants each of us to realize that we are together. We're to love one another. We're to pray for one another. We're to encourage one another. We're, the Bible says, and we keep repeating, we are laborers together with God. We're workers together with him. We are a unit. We work together as a team to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. As Steve mentioned here, people work behind the scenes, so many of you. They don't play an instrument. They don't sing specials. But they're very busy doing other things. Like Steve said, this just doesn't happen. Some people have to be busy doing things. And so people work in the church, use their services. They work where they serve the Lord, where they work on the job. Their family members, their loved ones, their friends, they're witness to those. And so you and I are specially called. The Bible says we are ambassadors of God. An ambassador is a witness of heaven's country. We're ambassadors, specially chosen by God to be representative of heaven. Can you imagine that? The only heaven anyone will ever see. The only Jesus that anyone will ever see when they look at you. The Holy Spirit of God right now is trying to conform us every day into the image of Jesus Christ as we yield to the Spirit of God and the Word of God as He molds us and shapes us in the image of Jesus. The way we live, the way we act, the way we conduct ourselves. Every day is a challenge for the child of God. We're laborers together with God. We're workers together with Him. We're His warriors. We're His workers. We are His witnesses. To start in Jerusalem, that's where you live, where you are, to be a witness unto Him. Then it says, you go into Judea and Samaria. We find that the people that God used is the Apostle Peter. He's predominant in chapters 1 through probably about 12. And about chapter 13 is where the Apostle Paul. I took a concordance and I found that Peter's name is mentioned at least 83 times in the book of Acts. We find that the Apostle Paul's name is 126 times, the word Paul. He might have been used in other names like Saul of Tarsus, but we find that these men were special. You and I are special today. The Bible says we've been chosen out of darkness into His marvelous light. We've been redeemed by the blood of Christ. We've been saved by the grace of God. We're kept by the power of God. And God wants us to be a witness, a warrior, and a worker. Soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ on a daily basis. How many of you love Jesus? Raise your hand. How many are glad you're saved? Raise your hand. How many of you going to heaven? Raise your hand. Praise God. But before we get there, God wants to use us down here in the nasty now, in the realm of the real, to be His witnesses, His warriors, and His workers. We're so glad we can do that. I want to thank you for coming, that we might share the book of Acts with you, the first chapter. They were waiting in the upper room, waiting for the power of the Holy Spirit of God to come. And when it comes upon you, you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the other part of the world. We're so thankful this is a missionary church.